Welcome to the Creating an Empowered Body, Mind, and Life podcast with your host, author, fitness entrepreneur, empowerment and transformation coach, Chris Ellerby-Hemmings. This podcast is about helping people find happiness through health, fitness, and mindset.
So, welcome back, guys. We've got another podcast, and today we've got a special guest. And I searched the internet and searched all of my contacts and people I've been following. I followed Brad for quite a long time. I've already given your name out. This is Brad Burton. Basically, what it is today is I wanted to kind of talk about being yourself, not hiding behind a mask, not going around life being fake. And I'm taking a quote from Brad here, which is being proper happy, not fake happy, which is what the world kind of makes us do. In society, we're all commodity, and the marketing world makes us buy things, makes us buy the Porsche, makes us change chase after the Lamborghini, makes us chase after the big business or the better body or the new supplement or the new diet or the new thing. And all of that boils down to trying to be happy, but proper happy, not fake happy. So today we've got Brad Burton on the podcast, and I want to first of all thank you for your time and thank you for allowing me to kind of interview you slash chat with you on the podcast. And I thought I can't give you justice by introducing you myself, so I'll let you just kind of explain who people are and why the hell they're going to listen to this guy from Salford who now lives in Somerset.
Yep.
To talk about being yourself. Like, do you know what I mean? Like, people think they're being themselves, but So Chris, maybe you can just introduce yourself a little bit and we can talk about...
So I've got no qualifications, none whatsoever. My teacher said to me, I never amount to anything. And up until 31 years ago, sorry, until I was 31, he was absolutely right. And then I changed. In that last, 30, I can't do my math now. In the last 12, 13 years, I started a business off. That business now is called 4networking, run over 5,000 business networking meetings across the UK, got thousands of members. And it's the largest joined up business network in the UK. I'm also an author. I've written 4 books. My first book is called Get Off Your Ass. The latest one's called Now What. I'm the highest rated and reviewed business author on Amazon. And I'm also a motivational business speaker. I speak at the likes of JCB, The Business Show, Sage, Zero, blah, 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 the NHS. And I motivate these people. And I'm the kind of guy who's, look, if you can see, I've got tattoos on my forearm. I look like a drug dealer. You know, I'm not anymore. Joking, you can edit that. But the point I'm making is that, listen, I'm a largely unexceptional guy from Salford who somewhere along the way changed his life. And actually now I'm a whole lot better for it. I am genuinely happy. I'm successful, doing well. I've got a nice balanced life in terms of family life. And life's good. It wasn't always that way.
So this is Brad. And obviously you speak to huge, huge audiences. What's your biggest audience?
Oh, 1,100, something like that. So, you know,
that's a big amount of people. Do you, like, obviously you're scared sometimes when you start off doing that, and it builds, and then you began to be more yourself when you started doing it, which made it less and less scary, or was it still the same?
So fear is always a thing when you, as a public speaker. I mean, it's a strange profession when you've got to walk into a room full of strangers and win them over, right? I mean, that doesn't make any sense. Think about it. But that's what you sign up for. And it's a bit like in your world when you go to a fresh gym. You know, when anyone goes into a fresh gym, what you think are like, all of a sudden, you're clocking the meat edge, you're clocking the people pushing weights there, and you're not, and it's like, yeah, you're disorientated. But as you get better and start being more comfortable in yourself, you go, hang about, I'm not a power lifter. Yeah. I'm never going to do that. That's not what I'm about. I'm not about putting 400kg stacks or whatever, right? That's not what I'm about. Yeah. I'm Mr. 14 kilo barbell curls. And as long as you're comfortable in that, then it's still the same gym that it always was.
Yep.
Still the same gym, but just your awareness of you and what you're about and what your goals are. So from the speaking thing, yeah, I get nerves. I'd be lying to you if I said I didn't. Genuinely, overcome those nerves, generally. Sometimes it does get the better in. There's no rhyme or reason as to why that's the case is. But what you can do, I do something called the Brad Camp, Be a Better Speaker. I train people to be speakers. One thing that I can say about speaking is that nobody can see your nerves, like genuinely. Like when I go and get like 20 people and I train them, I ask them to write down on a scale of 1 to 10 how nervous they are. And they're writing 8, 9, 10s. And then I ask everyone else who's watching them to write down how nervous they believe that the person is. And then when they sit down, I ask them for their scores and the other people. And I'm telling you, people can't see your nerves. So you have about 2 to get.
Something happened to myself when I was speaking at one event, and there was a particular person who I really could see wasn't enjoying it. He was just sitting there, body language, his arms were folded, he was looking around, he wouldn't catch eye contact with me, and we were going on, and I was helping him a lot with, it was a nutrition seminar, so we were talking, it was quite a large audience, not as big as your one there, but it was a big audience, and I was like trying to keep their attention, and everyone else was like really nodding and happy, and this one guy, and I was like, God, he's not getting it. And I'd learned kind of through books that you can't choose what's in someone else's head, and you can't change what's in his head, and you can't know what's in his head, like exactly what you just said. So I didn't know what was in his head. Come up to me at the end, and he was like, that was brilliant, that is. And he was really open. That was great. I enjoyed that.
Two things here. One, I remember when I launched 4networking going back in 2006, and there was 9-10 tables, and I remember saying, welcome to the future of business networking, which is what the words I opened up with.
Yeah.
And there was one table laughing and sniggering. And it's funny because I remember that table more than anything else. And in life, we do that. We remember the bad stuff. Yeah. And I'll tell you another story. That what you just said then about that, I've been exactly the same. I remember a guy came up to me afterwards, and I'm thinking, if you just stop the tape and say, right, what's this guy thinking? He thinks Brad's an idiot, blah, blah, blah. Can I be honest with you, Brad? I came here thinking you're a complete twat, and then I've gone away and you've changed my life, so thank you. It's like, whoa, where did that come from? Boom, it happens.
Yeah, that was really, really weird. It's like that. Let's just go back to that gym conversation, because when people go to a gym, the whatever we want to call it, the ego, we don't want to be too hippie or whatever, but the ego takes over. I explain it when I speak to people, it's like the Terminator. You know when the Terminator's looking around, it's like, and it's looking over there, that person's looking at me, that person's looking at me, oh my God, I've got to
have lifting more weight than me.
More weight than me. I've got to have my hair like this, and I've got to stand in a certain way, and then
what hair, Chris? Days are gone, fella. But yes, I get the point.
I'm still trying to keep hold of mine and keeping it as long as possible. But anyway, so people are like walking around the gym, and they're like, I can't do that, and I'm gonna lift that one extra weight extra than I normally lift because everyone's looking at me, and then I've got to have the best trainers on, I've got to have the best gym gear on, and I've got to buy that one because that person bought that one, and that guy's bigger than me, and I'm not as big as him, and we really don't want that in a gym. We want just people to be themselves. They want to enjoy their own journey, and it's like that's really what we don't want in a gym. So.
Yep.
I kind of explain this Terminator thing as being like externally motivated by what people see compared to what you want to do. So, for example, in a gym, you might be doing a bench press or whatever, and last week you got this many reps and you want to add a rep. Great, you win. You win an extra rep personally for you, not for the guy across the gym because he's probably not looking at you anyway, or the girl across the gym because they're not looking anyway. They're in their own mind, probably doing the same thing as what you're doing, going, oh my God, everyone's looking at me. Boom. So what we need to do is be ourselves and not be worried about what the other people think. So I kind of sat there for ages trying to work out how to explain to people how to start this process. And it was like process.
So here's the thing. This is something that I wrote about in one of my books, which is about finding your level.
Right.
Finding your level. See, it's all relative, right? It's all relative. So you pushing out 6 reps at your highest weight, whatever that weight is at bench, right? And me pushing out my 6 reps at my highest weight is relative. We're both working as hard. That's the reality of it.
Yeah.
But, you know, when you look at Muscle and Fitness magazine, everyone's looking at the Ronnie Colemans of the world or whatever who are pushing big plates.
Yeah.
They are only working as hard as you and I. They're no extra. They are at their capacity. But here's the thing about finding your level in life and business and in the gym, right? What we end up doing, if I look at the levels here, and I think me as an entrepreneur now, so there's Donald Trump, there's Richard Branson, there's Alan Sugar, and they're right up here, okay? Yeah. If I look up, on a scale of 1 to 10, they're 10. On the entrepreneur scale, I'm a 1 or a 2 on their scale. So I'm always 8 points away from their success. And if I'm always looking at them, I'm always going to feel a failure. So what I've done is I've changed all that. I said, fuck their scale off. I'm never going to be at that. Right? So I'm never going to be Tony Robbins. I'm never going to have myself a private island. I'm never going to have a private jet. Right? That's not what I'm about. But what I can have is a 5-bedroom house over in Somerset. What I can have is a PlayStation 4. So you've got to find your level. Stop looking at everyone else because that will drive you fucking mad. And that's why people become unhappy. Because you look at these entrepreneurs and you say, right, I want to have myself a Trump Tower. I want to have myself an Alan Sugar boardroom with, the AIDS. He's got, forget that. fucking be you.
So
be
how in your mind does people stop looking at other people? What's the first step for you? I've got my own process in it, but I wonder what's yours.
Ask yourself this question. 5 years back, if you could see yourself now, would you be happy, yes or no? And if the answer is yes, fucking bin it. If the answer is no, what have you got to change today in order to make yourself happy? I am telling you right now, once you realise, right, that you're not going to be Alan Sugar, once you realise you're not going to be Ronnie Coleman, right, but what you've got to be is the best that you can be. The best that you can be. See me, right, as a gym goer, I dick about. Right? I am genuinely Mr. 14, 16K curls. That's it. Yeah, I can do 24s, 12, but I don't. Right? Because then it's about me. And some the wisdom will say, hey, Brad, you should be doing more weight because, yeah, I get all that. But it's about fucking me. I'm quite happy with my level. Mm. Right? And this is the thing. I can go and look at your magazines and look at these guys and think, oh, I'd love to be like that. Yeah, I would love to be like that. Can I be asked? No. And that's the thing. Can I be really asked macroing and weighing out tuna 8 times a day? No. Can I be asked not going out for a curry? No. So once you accept that, stop being wistful. See, here's the thing. Seeing too many people all tuned into that whole thing, oh, I'd love to have a Lamborghini. Right. There's no point in making a dream so big that it becomes a nightmare. And I'll tell you something about that old Lamborghini shit. Right. Is that in my mind's eye, I wanted all that. And I'm telling you right now, right, it doesn't create your happiness. I've got a friend of mine with £20 million worth of supercars, right? 20 fucking mil. On a scale of 1 to 10, 10 being Brad happy, 1 being miserable, is a 2 or a 3. You go down to his Mayfair property, underfloor garage, the lights go on like something out of the Fast and the Furious, blink, 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 all monogrammed dust covers, right? All the same with a monogrammed, pulls it off, Bugatti. Whoa, do you want to have a spin of it? But it's got some poke. You go around Mayfair, everyone's taking photographs at the traffic lights, bum, 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 bum. And then you drive it in after 2 miles of fucking crawling on for 45 minutes, drive it back in there, blink, 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 lights go off, dust cover over, end of story. You spend your fucking life showing everyone what you've got, right? You don't enjoy it, you spend your fucking life showing everyone what you've got. And you end up doing it so your life is not yours.
Yeah.
The same goes for bodybuilding, it's a tough game as well. You spend your life vindicating yourself. And I'll tell you something, it's non-sustainable, as you know, right? It's not, you know, bodybuilders cannot sustain that amazing physique. So
it's a very short-lived thing. So people look at pictures of me on the internet and they're like, whoa. And I'm like, yeah, but that's only for the little 10 weeks when I get it. And I do that every 3 years or so.
Are you really?
Yeah, and that's all I do it. So I'm a natural bodybuilder, so I do it every 3 years or so. And what I've done is I've set my life up. So when I first started competing, it was all about this. Everybody else is looking at me. If I get this amazing physique, everyone is going to respect me so much more. Everyone's going to like me. I was really insecure. Got on stage, did it. And I remember this moment. And I'm on stage and I've done my first show. I was like shaking like a leaf backstage. I was really nervous. And then you started calling out the names. And you were like, I'm just on the back line with like, there's like 16 guys. And he went, and the fourth place trophy goes to Chris Ellerby-Hemmings. And I stood down on that line like, what? What, me? What? Why? I had no idea. And I was like, cool. And I was like completely cold, like, what? Why have I won? So I went to the front, got the trophy, felt a bit spaced out that I'd got it. But then the thing is, the next day, woke up, and I still felt this shitty, unhappy feeling.
Right. So here is the thing. Here is the thing.
And it was just a trophy.
Chris, listen to this. Because this is bang on. What you've got here is absolutely right. So I did it with my thing, with my frigging business. I've got this national business that I'd, in my mind's eye, I had this vision and nobody else could see it. And I created this vision. And it's a bit like being somebody who's a kid who looks at Mount Everest and says, one day I'm going to climb you, and they spend all their life training, getting altitude training, getting acclimatized, they get the Sherpas, they get to the base camp, they get there, they get to the top of Mount Everest, put a flag in the top, and they look over the vista and think, what a load of shit. It's just a fucking mountain. Yet you spent your life's work on something that you thought would then make you happy. Yeah. It doesn't. And this is why you've got, look, I am from Salford, Manchester, proper, right? I'm telling you, my whole approach right now is I find beauty. I took a picture the other day of daffodils, right? Daffodils. Yeah. I'm 6 foot, 15 and a half stone, and I'm taking pictures from Salford, taking pictures of daffodils because I'm finding the beauty in everything. And this is what you've got to do, because there's no point in going, you know, you look at it, squad goals, frigging Lamborghinis and Rolexes. I am telling you, it is empty. I have so many people that I know who have made shitloads of money, and yet they're broken inside. They're empty, because that's why they think that by buying a car, the happiness that is eluding them will be there. By getting the next lap answer, the happiness that eludes them is there. By getting the next supplement, by getting more body mass, the happiness that is bullshit. So this is what you've got to do. You've got to find that happiness and contentment within yourself. Now, as you can gather, I am from Salford. I am in no way a fucking hippie, right? I'm not. But I'll tell you something. I was pursuing that I thought that happiness was everywhere else apart from where I am today. Because the future that you once wanted is today. This is what you wanted. You signed up for this life 5 years ago, and you've got it. And your success, and anyone watching this, your success or failure will be defined by your ability to make decisions, good ones and bad ones. And I was making some fucking bad decisions 5-6 years ago, and I unraveled. I had a nervous breakdown. I've got type 2 diabetes now, right? And you think to yourself, how fucking stupid have you got to be to get type 2 diabetes through bad diet? Because I was warned by the doctor. He said, oh, you're having too many cans of Red Bull. I'm only doing 5 in a day. He's laughing more than I was. How shit.
Jesus Christ.
Oh, it's giving me rings. It's giving me... Fucking idiot.
Full sugar as well, I guess.
Mate, yes.
Yeah.
And not only that, you're also doing KFCs on the road. You're not only that, you're going, oh, snicker. I'm working hard. I'm an entrepreneur. I'm working really hard. Look, grinding and hustling. Nonsense. And this is the thing. People are so busy being busy. People are so busy. And I'll tell you what I do now. The way that I've got my happiness and my shit together right now is rather than working 8, 12 hours at 100%, at 50%, I work 4 hours at 100%.
Yeah, I like
and
that.
And it's a complete different vibe. So I've got more time to be happy playing fucking Ghost Recon on my PlayStation 4 or going skimming pebbles with my kids. Because I just see too many people but thinking that success, if they work really hard, they're going to... And it's a bit like what you said, mate. Now, I'm taking nothing away from what you've achieved. For you to have come first and to get those pictures, I wish I had pictures like you. I don't, right? Because I'm not prepared to do it. I am not prepared to work like that. And I think anyone who's watching this needs to be honest about it. Needs to be honest, because I ended up with success, right? I was successful. Success. I was ill. I created myself ill and a nervous breakdown. Like, and if you think about you going to the gym or any individual here lifting any weight, you lift weight up and there comes a point when you can't lift anymore and it strains and it causes you problems. Well, guess what? Your brain is a muscle. When was the last time you took it to a brain gym? When was the last time that you went, you know what? I need to be kind here. I'm reaching capacity. Never. And that's why it causes you problems. You've got to start looking after yourself. My priorities going back 5 years ago were 1, business, 2, family, 3, health. Right? And as such, I had a multi-million pound business. Family, I was one day away from divorce. Oh, and I had a nervous breakdown and type 2 diabetes. So I flipped it now. My priorities are 1, health, 2, family, 3, business. Now, it's taken me 11 years to reach that conclusion. And I'm not suggesting that anyone starting out can do that, because you need to throw a lot into the well at first. But I'll tell you something. On my last dying death and my dying breath, I'm not going to say, fucking hell, I wish I'd have spent more time in the gym. We're not going to turn around and say, I wish I'd have spent more time on proposals. Mm. What I am going to say is, I wish I'd have spent time being healthier.
Being healthier.
My family, exactly.
I'm working out to be healthy. So, like, actually, going back to this bodybuilding thing, it's not, this is, people listening to this won't be into that and into bodybuilding, but because I'm a bodybuilder, it's kind of great to talk about it. So that's
natural
bodybuilding, yeah. So UK Drug Free Bodybuilding Association, BMBF. So I went from the 2012 show, which was very egotistically motivated, and that story there. Had 2 year break where, obviously, guys who know about bodybuilding, is when you most of your work's done, you're doing your lifting, you're continuous. So you're living healthily, which is great. So I'm getting my food in, I'm making sure I'm controlling my food, it's making my life have structure. I'm going to the gym like 3 to 5 times a week. I've got structure. I'm being healthy. I'm working through my daily little snippets of happiness. So I'm keeping a track of my training. And when I get a little bit better, I'm like, okay, cool. I'm getting better. I'm improving.
Yep.
So then it gets to 2014 and I do another competition. This time it was completely different. I didn't care if I won. I didn't care if people were looking at me. I literally had no care whatsoever. to the point where it was actually difficult to get into that shape because of the need to be egotistically motivated by the people around me. So I was like struggling a bit, like, well, if I don't care, why am I doing it? But then I realized that I had to build up a lot of things around this mindset and this health, and, you know, my genetics are quite crap anyway. So, you know, my body fat set point's quite high, so it's good for me to stay.
Yeah, I know that one, fella. Yeah.
It's good for me to stay in shape and keep active. So I've got all these things around it, and I compete every 3 years, which keeps me doing this for the long term. Then this year, I'm just in the middle of getting ready for it again, and it's a bit weird again because I'm not doing it for other people. I'm doing it for myself, and I've progressed a lot more. So that's kind of the story around this bodybuilding thing. But what I wanted to go back to was this Terminator thing, what we're talking about. How did I personally go from looking at everybody else, walking down the street going, are they looking at that stain I've got on my t-shirt? Are they looking at that because I've just spilt my food? Are they looking at my shoes? Are they looking at that bag I've got on? Do they not like it? How did I go from that being obsessively insecure and shy but outspoken? So I was shy inside, but I was outspoken. I had this mask on. How did I go from that to changing? So my first thing was trying to get this Terminator thing and realize I was doing it, being self-aware. Okay, so I'm walking down the street and I'm looking at other people. So I'm going, look at that guy over there. He's got that nice car. I want that. Look at that guy over there. He's got that thing I want. And then the opposite, I'm going, look at that idiot over there. Why is he doing that? Look at that fool in the gym. Why is he doing that? So all I did was I turned off this, or like I had a break where I went, I'm going to stop judging other people. So I'm going to stop looking at their shoes or their watch or their car or, you know, the shape of their body or why they've got the hair like that or why are they talking in that manner. I'm going to turn that off and I'm not going to judge. I'm going to be aware of it. Then I'm going to turn off the wanting the other thing that they've got. Mm. And then all of a sudden, this being myself came around where I was just like, oh, I don't care as much anymore because they're probably not looking at me. And if they are, I can't choose to know whether they're looking at me or not. And then I became a lot more comfortable.
That comes back down to finding your level. See, you're in show business. You're in show business. What you do is in show business. There's no point in me turning around and saying I'm a natural bodybuilder if I'm at 26% body fat or whatever figure I've got at the moment, right? There's no point in me doing that, right? And this is the thing. You are in show business. So what you say and how you say it is going to have an impact. Same goes for me. So I'm completely with you on that one. But what I will say is you're still in show business. You still need to look good. Because otherwise, you've got to be the product. Yeah. For you to turn around and give people confidence, you need to look great. For me to be a motivational business speaker, guess what? I've got to be motivational about business speaking. Yeah. So there's a level. And this is the thing. I would love to be leaner. No question. Can I be asked? No. That's the reality of it. And I think that's that comes back down to every single individual.
Yeah.
You know, reading Muscle and Fitness magazine doesn't get you fit, right? Reading about macros and recipes doesn't get you fit. Doing it does. And that's the difference. Yeah. And I'd rather be honest with myself and happy rather than dishonest with myself and unhappy, which is what happens. Because you look at everyone else and you think, well, I wouldn't, you know, you can keep reading the muscle and fitness magazines, believing. I mean, the supplement game's an interesting one because I genuinely, other than the last few years, felt that supplements was legit, as in, like, you can do that by having these powders and stuff on it. I've been somewhere along the way, you guys seem to have took me under your wing, the old fitness industry, which is lovely. But I've sort of seen what that game's about, that actually you having these frigging powders and creatine and stuff doesn't change you from where you are, Brad, to where you want to be. It's everything else that's associated with that. Yeah. And I think that in life is a good metaphor for life, in that it's not one thing. There's not one thing that fixes anyone's life. There's lots of decisions, as you just said then, turning this Terminator thing off. That in itself would be one thing, one factor towards feeling happier.
Yeah, it's this, when I present on seminars myself, I talk about this sales funnel of the £60 billion industry. I went to uni last year myself, and it was like, I was very similar to yourself. I was like struggling, I was uneducated, and you know, I hear you talk about. Hey, I was actually obese when I was 19, 20. Yeah, I became obese. I was following, and there's actually a bit of a story to it where I was following all of the magazines, so obsessive with wanting a six pack and wanting to be in shape, and because everyone looks at a bodybuilder and think, that they must know what they're doing all the time. But I went from this 16, 17, 18, 19 years old person so obsessed with looking at the magazines and wanting to be in shape that I ended up creating an eating disorder for myself. So I was going, my worst one was tuna every 3 hours and a pickle every 15 minutes because I thought the pickle would speed my metabolism up and I thought the tuna would give me like massive gains. And this obviously lasted only Monday to Friday and then I'd break on the weekend. So when I got to like Friday night, I found myself in the kitchen several times where for my thing, mine was Cocoa Pops. I'll just have one bowl of Cocoa Pops and I'd pour it and I'd get halfway through that bowl of Cocoa Pops and then I'd be like, I'll just top it up. And by the time I'd got through it, I'd ended up eating the entire box and then I'd break down, I'd be crying because I'm like, but I want this six pack. Oh, what's going on? It's my mind's not strong enough. And what it was is this industry had destroyed my mind, destroyed my willpower, and I was not eating enough food Monday to Friday. I was killing the gym. And then at the weekend, I was overeating and I was binge eating. And this took many, many years and a lot of learning, a lot of like educators to help me get rid of it myself, which is why I'm passionate about helping other people do that. And that's where it's come from. But yeah, that was like the issue was this industry. So I take this sales funnel talk and what happened to me and what happens to everyone. And this has gone on for the past, like since the internet, so like 20 years, but more so in the last decade. Is this sales funnel down to this one thing. And this one thing is the protein powder, the supplement, the thing that's going to make you happy, or fake happy. So what happens is this £60 billion industry goes, right, let's make them all scared of carbs. Let's make them all scared of fats. Let's make them all scared of salt. Let's make them all think that you've got to not eat at nighttime. Let's make them all think that you've got to eat every 3 hours. Let's make them all think that this. So everyone then is all the left with, and all I was left with, was protein and no carbs, no fats, and supplements. So I was taking loads of supplements. My cupboard was full of supplements, and you all down to this one thing. One of the most profitable forms of food in the world is whey protein powder. And all the supplement companies have accidentally done it, so everyone's left with one thing, and what's that? To buy protein powder because they can't eat tuna all day long.
Fascinating. Absolutely fascinating to see that. You see, you know, I look at this. I got type 2 diabetes, as I said, and that's as a direct result of frigging bird's eye potato waffles. It's a direct result of bird's eye crispy pancakes in the 70s. You know, when I say that, I don't mean one set. I'm on about conditioned that actually this stuff's fast, convenient, and so forth. Because my children eat beautifully. So my generation sort of fucked it all up, really, with that whole nutrition stuff. And then you've got, like you say, this, as you just talked about, this funnel, where it's gone too extreme. There's something called sensible eating, isn't there?
Yeah, this balance thing. I talk about this balance. It sounds boring. And I suppose
sustainable, though. Yeah.
Sustainable, and that sounds boring. So when we teach on Empowered by Eating, people go through this really simple online system. It's you've heard about flexible dieting and macros, right? It's a bit overcomplicated, but what we've done is broke it down into five levels. Level one is just teaching people how to have this balance around calories, and people are losing like 100 pounds on it and things, and it's dead cheap. It costs them a tenner a month, and he might stay on it for 3 or 4 months.
Right? Okay.
But then he'd trial it for a pound, whatever. But basically, they're finding through the videos, through the written content, through the step-by-step guide, balance, and that's it. Like, we're like, eat food, but eat it in a balanced manner. Like,
totally.
Eat normal stuff. Like, some guy I was speaking to yesterday was like, I'm not allowed to eat crisp because I heard crisps carbs are bad. And I'm like, oh, well, all right, if you find balance.
That's right. Listen. There's one thing, having a pack of cheese, Walker's cheese, none in crisps. Another thing, old school days, doing 3 or 4 packets and actually not batting an eyelid, thinking there's a problem with that, which is what I used to do.
Or 12. Or 12, like this guy I was talking to yesterday was 12.
That's going to cause you a problem. It's not going to cause you a problem instantly, but you did it over the course of a life or years, or, you know, that's you in trouble. You're in trouble. And I think this is the thing about nutrition. I think we are more aware and less aware at the same time.
Yeah.
So confusing to work out. You know, if you go back to the 40s, they was healthier then.
Yeah.
You know, after the war.
Yeah.
So this overeating thing, which, you know, I'm guilty as charged on. Is a modern generation thing almost? Yeah. It's odd. I mean, diabetes for me is something that really, I'm so pissed off with myself. I'm disappointed with myself.
Your past self.
Yeah. But listen, you know what? I'm no angel now, but I'm certainly more mindful of it than ever before. I'm just disappointed with myself that you've got a guy who's pseudo intelligent, seemingly, has managed to create himself a bit of a drain on the NHS. That's sad. And you know, there's hundreds of thousands of us. That's disgusting. And like I say, I'm doing my bit in my own daft way to try and make a positive difference in terms of for people. I'm just a normal guy. You know, I'm no bodybuilder. I'm not in that world. But what I do when I speak in front of the crowds, like I do 3-4 times a week, is I share this whole thing that, you know, that is down to my decisions. And actually, in fact, my success and failure in my life has been down to my decisions in the same way that your success as a bodybuilder, it's been down to your decisions.
Yeah.
You know, you've been strong enough to not go and do the 12-pack of multi-pack of crisping.
Yeah. Well, it was about social. It was about psychological, like the muscle, what we spoke about earlier on, increasing the brain's capacity to do shit and get shit done. Yeah. So if I can compete in bodybuilding, I can then take that mindset and that struggle and that pain. It's not really that much pain on the body. It's pain on the mind.
Oh, get it.
When you get that and you go, it creates this breed of creature or whatever, like it is able to get on stage. Everybody that gets on a bodybuilding stage is a winner because you've got to them levels of body fat. That's not natural. It's an extreme sport. It's ridiculous.
One of my exes used to be NABBA. She's competing not swimwear, the one above that, in between the bodybuilders. So I get it. You know, distilled, it was back in the day. Distilled water, is it?
Yeah.
I mean, I tasted this and going, you know, 2 days out, whatever, distilled water. Ugh, fucking hell. I mean, you've got to be some sort of special edible to be able to pull that off. And that's what I'm saying. But there's an expectation that looking at these pictures, that's attainable. And for the vast majority of people, it's not. A better version of me is attainable. I'm 96 kilo at the moment. And when I start looking really good, it's at 93, right? So I get it down from 96, I get it down to 93, and then I think, oh, crisp. I forget that I'm on my way down. It's nuts. So I get to 93 and I end up between 93 and 96. And like, that's crazy. That is like genuinely, I can do it. And there's days when actually you just eat clean, everything's good. And there's days when that's just not an option. Mm. And it's funny because once you know that this is a head game, that you're human, you're fallible, you ain't perfect. Once you, and that applies in business, relationships, life, whatever you do, once you recognise that, you're a whole lot happier. But when you beat yourself up for having a Snickers bar, stop.
Yeah.
Stop. You know, you're not a machine. You're not a Terminator.
Not a Terminator. We'll have to call this podcast something about a Terminator. it's so funny. So I'm not sure where to take it next. It's about trying to help other people kind of get from being motivated by other people... unhappy and then being happy. It's like this turning point, isn't it?
So here's the thing with me. I'm 44 now, 31 year old. I was delivering pizzas to keep my business afloat, right? I felt like a piece of shit. And the reason I'm saying that is not to be dramatic. The reason I'm saying that is that if you're waiting tables right now, if you're delivering pizzas to keep your dream alive, or whatever dream you're keeping alive and you've got some sort of struggle, right? Pat yourself on the back. Don't beat yourself up. See, my teacher said to me, I never amount to anything. And up until 12, 13 years ago, he was right, but I changed, and we can all change. Because here's the thing, my ingredients are exactly the same, a little bit whoa, a little bit whey, cheeky chapper, you know, blah, 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 willing to take a risk. The only thing that has changed is my recipe. So I'm still the same guy that had been unemployed for 4 years, been addicted to drugs twice, and you've got to work really hard to get addicted twice. Still, that same guy who's got no qualifications, who is the highest rated business author, who speaks for these global brands, right, who also runs several businesses. You know, I'm still the same guy. So this is about you finding the best version of you, the best version of you on every level. But I'll tell you something. Over the last 11, 12 years of me running businesses, I've wanted to quit 11 times. So let's not pretend that it's easier. Oh, well, I can't do it because I've got a newborn boy. Well, I did as well. I was 25 grand in debt. 25 grand in debt when I started my business off. A wife that wanted me to go and get a proper job. So don't tell me you can't do it. Right, because it all starts with this belief, believing that you can. Because when I started my businesses off, that's all I had. I had no fucking money. So all I had was guile my brain and put that into gear. See, as businesses start getting bigger and people start getting more successful, you can start using money to buy yourself solutions. Now, what I do, even where I'm at right now, is the first business tool and the best business tool that I use every single time is my brain. And I see people, they stop using that. And actually, the same goes for the bodybuilding game. Yeah. They stop using these techniques, those things that have got them to where they are, and start going, oh, look, the next thing. Nah. So I would say to any single individual watching this, ditches his drugs twice, 4 years unemployed, 25 grand in debt, newborn boy, baby Ben, no qualifications, dad was a heroin addict, multi-million pound business now, 4 books, highest rated reviewed business author on Amazon. What's your excuse? Because I tell you something, your excuse is the one that you're telling yourself, and you're either going to start talking yourself into things or start talking yourself out of things. And my advice to you is start talking yourself into things. So if you want to get fitter, start today. Or be honest about it and say, like me, you know what? I'm never going to be a bodybuilder type, but what I will do is I'll have some, in my world, arms that I'm quite comfortable with. Because there was a time when I was so embarrassed about myself that I used to wear jumpers and stuff. Do you know what I mean? And that's not good, because now you're not feeling happy. So I'm happy with myself. I'm happy with the fact that I've got a 34-inch waist, right? It was up to 42, 44 at one point, and even then I realised it's a problem. So I'm quite happy. Would I prefer to be thinner? Yes. Would I prefer to have bigger arms? Yes. Can I be asked? No. And I think that's what you need to be. You need to be honest with yourself, because that's where you'll find your happiness. That's where you'll find your true contentment. But I'll tell you something, you will not find it in frigging supplements. You will not find it in getting a Lamborghini. You will not find it in being able to buy a Rolex watch. Because I'm telling you, that this kind of stuff is only valuable when you can't afford it. And the watch that you want, the car that you want, no longer has that same pulling power when you can afford it. I'm telling you that now.
And this didn't happen overnight, did it?
No, mate. You know, listen, you know, nervous breakdown, type 2 diabetes, marriage on the rocks, and some real personal struggles over the last 11 years. And I think that's what you've got to understand. See, people watch frigging Dragon's Den, you know, 15 minutes with Theo and Peter, next thing going away with £250,000. That's not the real fucking world. The real world is buying something for 50 pence, selling it for £1, and doing that for fucking 11 years. And if you ain't prepared to do that, stick with your proper job. At least you know where you stand.
Yeah.
See, you don't know where you stand. Look at HSBC, they just let 6,000 people go. When you run your own business, you know exactly where you stand. Fucking skint, get used to it. But you ain't going to starve to death. So what's the risk? The risk is, if it doesn't work out, go and get a proper job, which is exactly the point where you started. Fucking, yeah. Listen, use this. Because every single decision that you've ever made in your life has brought you to this video today. And there's a reason for that. Either one, you just like listening to me and Chris have a riff. Or maybe, just maybe, I'm talking to you. And maybe you're looking for permission. You're looking for that fucking permission to make the change that you need to, in the same way I was 11, 13 years ago, what it was.
So let's leave it there. And let's let everybody else kind of digest that. It's probably going to take you 2 or 3 listens and a pad and a pen to write down everything that Brad has just come out with there. Because he does speak fast. He's from Manchester. So I'd like to thank you very much, Brad, for your time. That's absolutely awesome. I've learned a lot. The people listening, they will have definitely learned a lot as well. And we're going to share this across social media and hopefully maybe change 1 or 2 people's lives, maybe make them progress and get a little bit better on a daily basis.
Chris, what I'd suggest that anyone who's interested in this, if I've resonated in any way or form, like genuinely resonating, check out nowwhat.biz, right, which is my next project. Yeah. You know, I've spent the last 13 years building this network up. I've now got a new project, nowwhat.biz, which is about that, making life-changing decisions.
There we go. Thanks for your time, Brad.
Cheers, champ. Take it easy.
Thank you very much. Bye.